pleasure and honor to have again with us Professor Pietro Loiacono from the University of Palermo, who is our old friend. He was teaching 2 years ago, I think, in Belgrade. It was really a nice lecture. It was another period of time, so we had audience which was just much more massive. Thank you. But it is not important how many people we have. Old Romans used to say, non multum sed multa. I'm happy to say that I have here also my ex-student at the doctoral studies, and I'm so happy that he is also with us, and many other colleagues from different generations, as you can easily see, starting with beers, ending with those very, very young students all around. Pietro is very knowledgeable scholar in the field of ecclesiastical law, state and church law, and particularly great expert for a wonderful topic that I discovered yesterday through his new book that he gave to me. It is about relationship between the state and church, and the terminology that we use according to the Byzantine model, papo-caesarism and caesaropapism. You see that my students know that. In Italy is differently shaped, which is the term
regalismo.
Regalismo. Regalismo, and this is one of the topics that I would like you to explain, among other things, speaking about your main topic, which is the position of Catholic Church and other denominations in the Italian Constitution. But along with that, I would be really very happy if you can explain the Italian view and terminology, better to say, about Caesaropapism and Papo-Caesarism. Papo-Caesarism basically does not exist as a term.
Sì, in Italy we call papocesarismo teocrazia, the government of God, literally. And in our experience, it's the government of the Pope.
Because thank you so much, and go on explaining that. Okay. Welcome, we are happy to have you.
Thank you, Simon. Good evening, and thank you very much to Professor Avramovic for all his kindness, especially for the invitation to give this lecture. I am happy and honored to be here again. It's my second time at Forum Romanum in front of such a well-qualified audience. Please excuse my bad English, and I trust in your goodwill and patience. My lecture will concern the topic about the Roman Catholic Church and the non-Catholic denominations in the Italian Constitution. And I will analyze this topic through the most important rules of the Italian Constitution and the most substantial judgments of the Constitutional Court. The new Italian Constitution, which was stipulated in 1948, is based on democracy, equality and fundamental rights. Departing from the previous Constitution, we call the previous Constitution Statuto Albertino, of 1848, which defined Roman Catholicism as the sole religion of the state, the Constitution of 1948 does not define Italy as either a Catholic or a secular state. However, our Constitution includes several articles explicitly referring to religion, and I think it's better to start with the article that established about religion in general. And then we can analyze some articles about Catholic Church and other denominational groups. And the first article is Article 3 of the Italian Constitution, which solemnly proclaims the principle of equality, and he established that all citizens have equal social dignity and are equal before the law, without distinction of sex, race, language, religion, political opinion, personal and social conditions. And this principle of equality is reiterates about in Article 20 that states for a prohibition to discriminate amongst religious organizations. It applies the principle of equality to religious organizations, and it establishes no special limitation or tax burden may be imposed on the establishment, legal capacity or activities of any organization on grounds of its religious nature or its religious or confessional aims. Principle of equality about people, principle of equality about entities. But another important article is Article 19 of the Italian Constitution. It also concerns religion in general, and special individual and collective freedom to profess and promote religious beliefs and to perform rites, because it establishes anyone is entitled to freely profess their religious belief in any forms, individually or with others, and to promote them and to celebrate rites, in public or in private, provided that they are not offensive to public morality. The only explicit limit is not offensive to public morality. And it is about religion in general. But the Italian Constitution has also some articles about the Catholic Church and other denominational groups. And about the Catholic Church and other denominational groups, very important is Article 8, Section 1, states that all religious denominations, religious denominations are equally free before the law. And this is the only constitutional provisions which explicitly addresses the Roman Catholic Church and the other denominations at the same time. It's the only provisions about Catholic, Roman Catholic Church and other denominational groups at the same time. And very important is the reference of this article to equal freedom instead of equality. In fact, the Constituent Assembly rejected the formula submitted representing the anxieties of religious minorities that all religious denominations are equal before the law. Was established another sentence that talks about not equal before the law, but equality in order to freedom. Thus, Constituent Fathers did not frame collective religious freedom as implying strictly the same treatment of all religious denominations. They simply prohibited any different treatment which would affect equality in the enjoyment of collective freedom. Different treatments are possible only if they do not affect collective freedom and are also not unreasonable. Forcing the same treatment onto objectively different religions would betray justice and true equality. Along this line, the Catholic preference is defended as the obvious consequence of the social salience of Catholicism in the country. However, tenants of a more rigid and scrupulous enforcement of formal equality argue that minorities need more protection than majorities. In this moment, in Italy, equal collective religious freedom is challenged by the persistence of the 1929 Act on Permitted Cults. This is a general act made during the fascist regime, granting that every Catholic denomination is permitted, provided it do not follow rites contrary to morals. But this act contains a mandate to the Minister of the Interior to monitor denominations other than Catholic Church with no agreement. And the problem is if this mandate withstands serious constitutional scrutiny with regard to the respect of collective freedom in general and of equal freedom in particular. Because according to this act, the articulations of the ministry, locally the prefects, have the power to check whether religious communities respect the law and their own internal statutes. Such a problematic competence is only mitigated by the caution with which the authorities of the ministry discharge their duties. Since the early 1990s, several projects of the Parliament General Act on Religious Freedom replacing this act have been presented, but none has been enacted yet. In the last serious attempt in 2007, a Religious Freedom Bill was approved in the Parliamentary Commission for Constitutional Affairs but not carried further. The problem is still unresolved. Other constitutional rules regulate the conditions of the Catholic Church and of non-Catholic denominations. In particular, the status of the Roman Catholic Church is regulated by Article 7 of the Constitution. The first section of this article proclaims the independence and the sovereignty of the state and the Catholic Church respectively. The second section recognizes the Lateran Pacts and regulates the introduction of modifications. What are Lateran Pacts? Lateran Pacts are some agreements between the state and the Catholic Church which were stipulated in 1929 during the fascist regime, and they comprise a treaty which established the Vatican State, the state of the Pope, a concordat that regulates the condition of Catholicism and the Catholic Church in Italy, and a financial settlement. The independence and the sovereignty of the state and the Catholic Church respectively is proclaimed by Article 7, Section 1, in the following terms. The state and the Catholic Church are independent and sovereign, each within its own sphere. This principle has been reiterated in Article 1 of the Accordo of Villa Madama of 1984, which substitutes the old concordat. The second section of Article 7 deals with the problem of the Lateran Pacts that had survived the end of fascism. In the name of the most radical departure from the religious policy of fascism, some political force, in particular liberals and socialists, vocally demanded the repeal, if not the treaty, at least of the concordat. But the Christian Democrats found it unacceptable to denounce the Lateran Pacts and to reopen the problem about the relationship with the Pope. A solution was found when the Christian Democrats announced that they would support a future reform of the Concordat, thus leading communists to join for the sake of religious peace in the country. In fact, Article 7, Section 2 was forged accordingly as an instrument meant to secure the Lateran Pacts and to prepare the reform at a more convenient time. In fact, the article proclaims that the relations between the state and the Catholic Church are regulated by the Lateran Pacts. Amendments to such pacts, which are accepted by both parties, shall not require the procedure of constitutional amendments. It took place in 1984 with the agreement of Villa Madama, modifying and replacing the Concordat of 1929. The accordo deals with the same subject matter as the precedent Concordat, but is structured as a complete legislative act. Therefore, it is substantially a new concordat. It is a formalized as a modification of the former concordat, but in the truth, it's a new concordat. And now we can analyze some rules about other denominational groups. Article 8 regulates the status of denomination other than Catholic Church in Section 2 and Section 3. Section 2 recognizes the autonomy, not the independence, of non-Catholic denominations, but Section 3 allows for a special category of agreement, we call this agreement with non-denominational groups intesa, not concordat, we use the term intesa, at this agreement through which the relevant denomination of the state would regulate their relations. Section 2 of Article 8 acknowledges the autonomy of non-Catholic denominations by proclaiming that denominations other than Catholicism have the right to self-organization according to their own statutes, provided they do not conflict with Italian law. And the principle is thus articulated in two parts, the first proclaiming the right to self-organization according to the status of the relevant denominations, and the second qualifying the right to the respect of the Italian law. The right to self-organization according to one's own statutes is being categorized as implying that non-Catholic denominations, as well as their internal laws, are autonomous in character. It is impossible to use the word independent because they have to respect the Italian legal system, unlike the Catholic Church. The norm about the Catholic Church don't talk about the respect of the Italian law. The norm about other denominational groups talk about the respect of Italian legal system. However, Italian Parliament has made use of the word independence when it approved the first Intesa, the first agreement with the denominational groups different from Catholic Church, with Valdesians and Methodists of 1984. Article 2 of the Intesa states that the Italian Republic recognizes the autonomy and independence of Valdesians law. Article 2 of the Intesa specifies the principle by stating that the state will not interfere with the Valdesian ecclesiastical jurisdiction about nomination of religious minister and organization of the church. And the same principle has been repeated in other agreements. For instance, agreements with the Jewish communities. In this agreement, Jewish communities are recognized as original social groups. Denominations other than the Catholic Church are free to shape their own status, provided that they do not conflict with Italian law. This is not a rule on religious violations of the law of the land, but a specific exceptional limitation to denominational freedom of self-organization. During the debate deposed into the Assembly, the president of the drafting committee, Meuccio Ruini, justified the limitation clause by referring to the possibility that one day Italy be confronted with Islam, he mentioned the problem of polygamy, and with odd, weird cults of American kind, not respecting Italian law. And in its 1988 decision about the autonomy of Jewish communities, Italian Constitutional Court has ruled that the clause has to be interpreted in the sense that the right to self-determination is not incompatible with specific limitations resulting from particular norms, but only with the violation of fundamental principles of Italian law. For instance, in May 1986, the Council of State denied its favorable advice to civil recognition of Jehovah's Witnesses on grounds that further investigation was needed on the real scope of their objection to military service and blood transfusions. Recognition was later granted in October the same year. And now Section 3 of Article 8, this norm extends to all denominations the bilateral system of relations established for the Roman Catholic Church. However, the non-Catholic denominations do not enjoy the status of sovereign entities as the Roman Catholic Church does. Thus, the agreements with the state are not deemed to be as an international agreements like concordats, but as domestic agreements. Such a distinctive category of agreements is termed intesa, not concordat. Article 8, Section 3, providing for the relations of non-Catholic denominations with the state, established that these relations be regulated by law based on agreements with their respective representatives. And the application of Article 8, Section 3 is problematic. A balance between the prerogatives and the political appreciation of the government and the expectations and the rights of religious denominations is hard to strike. In general, it can be said that denominations have the right to ask the state to negotiate and stipulate intesa, but the denominations have neither the obligation nor the right to stipulate intesa. In turn, the state has the duty to take seriously the denomination initiative in view of the negotiation and stipulation of the intesa, but has no obligation to conclude intesa. The distinction is crucial between the right of the state to regulate unilaterally the status and the conditions of all religious denominations, as it is the case with the 1929 Act on Permitted Cults, and the state obligations to enter intesa if it wishes to regulate its relations with one specific denomination. Article 8, Section 3 of the Constitution does not prescribe a specific procedure for the negotiation and the conclusion of intesa, but practice and norms have established a standard, but non rigid compulsory path, an act of 1988 established that the competence is in the hand of the government, especially in the hand of the Prime Minister, because as the Prime Minister competent to sign the intesa with denominational groups. No prescription exists on the contents of intesa. So far, all signed intesa have included norms providing for the following topics: A. General recognition of the independence and autonomy of the denomination. B. Specific guarantees of no interference by the state with the denomination, for instance, freedom of the denominational press, for instance. C. Provisions for civil registration of the religious minister and of their activity, for instance, chaplaincy. D. Provisions for civil recognition of the religious marriages celebrated according to the ritual of the relevant denomination. E. Provisions for civil registration of the denominational bodies. Finally, ad hoc provisions for specific denominational entities. Signature of the agreement is not enough for the intesa to be legally binding. In fact, Article 8, Section 3 states that the relations of the state with non-Catholic denominations are regulated by law based on agreements with their representatives. This has been interpreted since the first intesa with Valdesians and the Methodists in the sense that an act of approval by Parliament is necessary for the intesa to be enforced. But the gap between the signature of the intesa and its approval by Parliament has not been a problem in the first phase from intesa with Valdesians and Methodists in 1984 to intesa with Evangelical Lutheran Church in 1993. Because all agreements have been approved by the Parliament within a reasonable amount of time. But this first phase finished with two intesa signed in 2000 with Buddhist and Jehovah's Witnesses. A political opposition materialized against the access of this religion to bilateral regulations, and the Parliament never approved the two intesa, which were signed again in 2007, together with others, with Mormon, Indus, the Ecumenical Patriarchate of Constantinople, and the Apostolic Church. For a long time, these intesa were not being examined by the Parliament. Although the political discretion of the Parliament is undisputable, many experts deem the delay in discussing the approval incompatible with the spirit of the Constitution. Finally, in 2012, Parliament approved 5 of the 6 intesa, but not the one with the Jehovah's Witnesses. This time, the Jehovah's Witnesses don't have any intesa with the Italian state. In some cases, modifications of intesa has been seen and approved by Parliament. And denominations with intesa are no longer bound by the Act on Permitted Cults. Thanks to the act approving intesa, the relevant denominations enjoy a significant symbolic recognition, including the explicit mention of its independence and autonomy. The social and political implications are noticeable. For instance, the denomination with intesa have a more favorable status about funding by state, about marriage, about entities, about religious minister. While differences exist from one intesa to another, the main framework is the same. This has prompted experts to criticize the betrayal of the constitutional mandate that warranted agreements to address the specific needs of the various denominations. In this moment, the different intesa are very similar each other. In fact, Italian scholars talk about replica agreements. Cioè, agreements that are the same, change only the name of the denominational group, and we call it intese fotocopia. Now, some conclusions. Experts have criticized the government decision to start negotiations with the Muslim representatives in view of intesa as being incompatible with the constitutional mandate, as well as the position of the Parliament, which is abstained from voting on the approval of several intesa signed by the government for a long time. In this moment, Italian doctrine criticized the position of the government, because in this moment the most important non-denominational groups in Italy, denominational groups different from Catholic Church, I guess, pardon, Jehovah's Witnesses and Muslim, don't have any agreement with the state. We have stipulated agreement with small groups, for instance, Lutheran in Italy are 6,000, and not agreement with the Muslim, they are 2 million in Italy, or with the Jehovah's Witnesses, there are 1 million, more or less. Quindi, however, as the result of normative stratification, Italy can be represented as a country based on the following legal principles and mechanisms: large protection of individual and collective religious freedom, and the formal non-identification of the state with the traditional majority religion and former state religion. Recognition and protection of non-Catholic denominations based on the principle of equal freedom of all religions and religious denominations. Finally, because it's the result and the summary of the previous principles, neutrality and independence of the state embodied in the principle of laicità. What is the source of Italian principle of laicità? And what is the Italian concept of laicità? The first answer is that the Italian concept of laicità was created by jurisprudence. In 1989, the Constitutional Court acknowledged for the first time that Italy was a secular state. In a seminal decision, the Constitutional Court construed laicità as one of the supreme principles which could be deduced from the Constitution, in particular from the principles of equality, non-discrimination on grounds of religion, and independence of the state from the Catholic Church. According to the Court, the principle supremo of laicità had to be considered as one of the aspects of the form of state outlined by the Constitution. Such a principle was not synonymous with indifference towards the experience of a religion, but represented the state's guarantee that religious freedom will be safeguarded in a framework of denominational and cultural pluralism. This trait differentiates the Italian concept of laicità from French or Turkish secularism, because the Italian concept is in favor of religion, namely in favor of every kind of religion, not against religion. Laicità italiana, Italian concept of laicità, isn't against religion. What kind of problems do we have to resolve about religious freedom and the relationship between state and religious denominations? Firstly, the concept of a religious group. Now, in Italy, there are more than 900 groups which qualify themselves as religious denominations. The Italian legislation does not contain a definition of religious denominations. Therefore, it becomes very difficult to decide if a group is a denomination or not. And the question is not secondary. The status of a denomination is very favorable, for example, about the possibility of spending public funding. Thus, it's possible that the groups which are extraneous to the religious phenomenon will try to use it. In Italy, we have had the case about a strange group called Jesus' Children or Family of the Love that affirms itself to be a denominational group, but in reality, it was a group to organize the prostitution, for instance. It would be necessary to have a law about the concept of a denomination, like, for instance, the Spanish legislation. But until now, Parliament has not taken up this question. Furthermore, only a few groups have agreements with the Italian Republic. According to Article 8, third section, the relationship between state and religious denominations, different from Catholic Church, have to be regulated by law grounded on agreement with the denominational group. In this moment, until now, only 12 denominations have stipulated an agreement with the government, agreement ratified by Parliament. A 13th has stipulated an agreement and is now waiting for endorsement by the Parliament. All other denominations do not have an agreement and therefore are still bound to an old statute might make during the fascist regime before the actual Constitution, statute called Law About Allowed Denominations. This is a big problem because the Law About Allowed Denominations is very different from the agreements. The agreements are influenced by democratic principles and establish a lot of advantages, especially about the use of public funds, taxes, presence in public school, and other topics. The law regarding allowed denominations is influenced by authoritarian principles. It's a law made during the fascist regime and does not prevede the same advantages established by the agreements. It's notable to highlight that among the denominations without agreement are the most numerous, like Jehovah's Witnesses and Muslim. Consequently, in this moment in Italy, Religious denominations do not have the same freedom. And this is an obvious violation of Article 8, Section 1 of the Italian Constitution, which recites all religious denominations are equally free. There are two possible solutions. Stipulate an agreement with every denomination, or substitute the law regarding allowed denominations with a new law which repeats the advantages established by the agreements. The first solution is practically impossible. The system was created in 1948, when denominational groups in Italy were more or less 10, 11, not more. Now, the high number of religious denominations makes a utopian ideal to think to stipulate an agreement with every group. The second solution is possible practically, but it needs an intervention by Parliament. Parliament cannot or does not want, I don't know, to substitute this old regulation with new rules. Until now, the question about the substitution of old laws has not been inserted in the planning of Parliament. Consequently, we continue to perpetuate a violation of the Constitution and a discrimination between denominations with agreement and denominations without agreement. This is a violation of the Italian Constitution and the opposite of democracy. This is an illegality which originates from the incomplete realization of the constitutional guarantee. This is paradoxical, and it proves the modernity of an ancient sentence according to which summum ius, summa injuria, from the strict respect of law, sometimes derives violation of justice and of equality. Thank you for your attention and your patience. Thank you.
The criminal jurisdiction of the Italian state, how is it normative? Because we are all today we hear about the scandals which are going on in Vatican, and I'm asking you if the Italian police has the right to intervene in the Catholic Church, arrest those people, and so forth.
Yeah. Vatican State is another state respect Italy, because Italian police doesn't have jurisdiction about crimes which are committed in the Vatican State. Vatican State has jurisdiction, is police, Vatican Gendarmerie, is judges. Italian State can punish the crime only if the criminal commits crime in Italy. This is the problem. Vatican State is another state, absolutely independent from the Italian state.
And the boundaries are the walls of the Vatican?
Please.
What are the boundaries of the Vatican State?
The boundaries? The boundaries is along the so-called Leonine Wall, so the wall by Pope Leon the 13th, mm-hmm. And the only difference is San Pietro Squares, because San Pietro Squares is Vatican State, but it is subject to the power of Italian police. Because if a crime happens in Vatican Square, it's possible to arrest the criminal or by the Vatican police or by Italian police. But it is the only part of Vatican State that is subject to power of the Italian jurisdiction. The other part in Italian State doesn't have jurisdiction.
Please. Questions, if I may. First, you mentioned that the current situation is, according to you, unconstitutional. But has someone raised such an objection before a court, or is it merely a theoretical assessment? Has it been raised as a question in practice? And the second, you mentioned the issue of the so-called protocolated cases, so the same agreements signed with the various denominations. Is someone objecting to that, or is it simply a situation that is good for both the denominations and the state?
Two different questions. question, if I have understood correctly. I think it's better to start from the second question. The problem of the Intesa is that the Intesa or agreement, in the mind of Father Constitution, of Italian Constitution, has a very, very important aim to respect the needs, particular needs, of one of every confessions. So in the mind of Fathers of the Italian Constitution, the Intesa is a tool to create a specific law about every denominational group. But when the Fathers of the Italian Constitution established the Italian Constitution, the denominational groups in Italy are very, 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 very few. There is because of 10 or 11, but it is the real. Yes, 10 or 11, not more. In this context, it's possible to think to a law for every confession, the national group. Now, confessional group are a lot, and Intesa has changed its nature, and it's become a tool to regulate the relationship between the state and the denominational group, but with the same rules for every group. The impression, if I read the agreements between the Italian state and the denominational groups, is that in the Minister of Interior or in the office of the Prime Minister, there are the text of one Intesa, they change the name of the group, and the other things remain the same. But it's a violation of the spirit of the Intesa. I don't know if I have an answer to this question, because in Intesa, in the mind of who created it, has another nature, not this kind. For instance, the Intesa with the Jehovah's Witnesses, the Parliament has never approved it, but in the Intesa, there aren't any notes about the more important questions of the Jehovah's Witnesses, for instance, objection to blood transfusions, objection to military service, objection to religious teaching in the school.
So it's become more of a license to have some additional rights than
I shall agree. But Intesa, who doesn't talk about the specific needs of the national group, in my opinion, it's not useful. It's not useful. It's possible to substitute the Intesa with one general law about all the national group. Oh, very welcome.
The Vatican monetary sovereign, the euro is under supervisory of the Bank of Italia.
Okay. About money. Okay. But the Vatican State has established an agreement with Italy about in order to the adoption of the euro, like money. But in this way, the Vatican State is included in the so-called area euro, and to become part of area euro, it's important to guarantee some standards of security about the circulation of money, about no recycling money who comes from crime and other forms of guarantee. And Vatican State has established some law about these problems, because without some acts, Vatican State cannot use euro like money. In this moment, there isn't a competence of Bank of Italy in order of this, because Vatican State has its tools to check the circulation of money. In particular way, the acronym is AIF, Authority of Financial Information, that is a Vatican authority, who checks the circulation of the money and who is tasked its tasks are to prevent and to punish crime in order to the circulation of the money inside the Vatican State. I don't know if I have answered to this question.
Concerning people which come to Vatican to work as officials, cardinals and other employees, does the Italian government have a say? Because if Vatican invites someone to come, that person can easily leave Vatican State and go walk around Italy, so it would be logical for Italy to have some say.
According to the treaty between Italian State and the Holy See, if the Holy See invites one person to go to the Vatican State, Italy must consent this. For instance, during the Second World War, the diplomatic representatives of the USA, of Great Britain, or other states who are the enemy of Italy, have the right to move to Vatican and behind the Italian state. It's a norm of the treaty.
Is the Italian state doing enough in order to protect the Roman Catholic Church? Because nowadays the entire Christianity is in a state of gradual decline. I mean, is it helping the Roman Catholic Church to survive, to withstand in the next century?
No, absolutely not. Italian state is formally a secular state. Catholicism is no more the religion of the state.
But in order to protect the Italian identity.
Allora, this is a very, 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 very hot topic in Italy in this moment. Because for some part of the public opinion, Christian faith isn't a part of the national identity. For some part of the public opinion. I belong to the other part, but for some part of the public opinion, Christian faith isn't a part of the Catholic identity. For instance, the questions about the crucifix, about the religion teaching in the school, about the possibility for the students of public schools to pray before the beginning of the lesson, for instance, or to the end of the lesson. And the Italian state, in this moment, has a position neutral in front of this problem.
But the thing is that the Christian Church and the Roman Catholic Church in Italy regarding the Italian nation is one of the founding cornerstones of, let's say, the last 1,000 years of Italian national consciousness, cultural history, and the Renaissance. The old days of Italian culture.
Absolutely. For it's impossible to think about Italian culture without the Christian faith. Absolutely impossible. Absolutely impossible. But not for our government in this moment.
An unfortunate moment.
Absolutely. But I don't think that the future will put better things. In my opinion, if I see the idea of the parliament, especially in this moment after the recent election, I don't think that the position of the Italian state will change in the future. I don't think.
What will be the future for the Italian people if the church is about crumble in the face of organization?
No. The problem is that we are creating a people with empty soul. This is the problem. This is
the problem that happened in the Great Britain and is currently happening.
We are creating the Great Britain is worse than Italy. But we are creating a people with an empty soul. Well, while young people, for instance, adhere to strange religion from the eastern of Asia, or for strange form of syncretism like New Age or other.
Yes,
New Age
is a religion.
Yes, strange.
Strange.
Yeah, absolutely. For instance, a lot of, no, not a lot, but some young people in Italy. decided to become a Muslim, for instance.
Why?
Why this? Especially a woman.
Why?
Italian.
Why a woman want to become a Muslim?
It's strange. Why a female born in Italy, educated in Italy, used to relation with male, decide to become Muslim. It's strange. In my opinion, in my humble opinion, the answer is the empty soul. And when a thing is empty, arrives something in this empty space. It's and not written a rule, but it's a rule very, very strong, in my opinion. My humble opinion, the problem is this. For instance, why I don't celebrate the Christmas in public schools? Why?
Why?
The schools close for Christmas holiday or not? Close. Close. And then why I don't celebrate the Christmas?
Why?
It's a stupid thing. It's worse than a crime. It's a stupid thing. But it happens in Italy in this moment. Not in every public school, but in a lot of public schools.
The strange thing is that there are thousands of so-called far left liberal people that are doing the Catholic bash and the propaganda against Catholic Church, but yet they are all very much compliant with Islam, and they are actually inviting people to believe in Islam.
No, the problem in this moment is that in Italy we have more or less 2 million of Muslims, more or less, because the most part of these are migrants, and it's impossible to check a lot of people, 2 million, more or less, and they want a lot of rights in Italy, but the problem is that they want that the Italy state recognize the confessional law, Sharia. And it's a problem, because...
It would be a danger even for the secularists.
Absolutely. But the strange thing is that some part of the parliament, which is very hostile in front of the Catholic Church, is not favorable to recognize the right to Muslim.
The same thing in
Yeah, and I don't know the limited situation, but I can imagine this. And it's a problem. In my opinion, it's a very dangerous situation, and we will pay a very high price in the future for this situation, in my humble opinion.
Perfect. Thank you so much. It was great.
You're welcome.